So the title of my talk is Turing, Probability, and Cryptography. So of course, this is going back a while, so the first kind of question you always have to ask is an answer is, who cares? Why is this a topic of any interest? Why do we care what Alan Turing thought about probability, let alone cryptography? Well, as has become fairly well known nowadays, during World War II, the Allies read many of the German crypto systems. And this saved many lives, especially in the war in the Atlantic. So there was this Enigma device that the German Navy used to communicate with the U-boats, and it was really helpful if you were in a convoy, if you knew the U-boat was over there, because you went over there. Furthermore, you could send your planes to go over there and take out the U-boats. So this actually, tens of thousands of lives, I mean, it's very hard to quantify this thing, but this actually had an enormous impact in the war in the Atlantic. And turns out that Alan Turing played a crucial role in this. So yes, he's very well known for Turing machines and his contributions to logic. He's well known also because he was interested in computer science, wrote this famous article on can a machine think? But he was also very active in this particular. And his approach was centered on the use of Bayesian statistics. So this is sort of interesting because, now nowadays people don't argue about Bayesian statistics as much as they used to. But there was a period where Bayesian statistics was not in favor, and even when it started coming back in favor, you would have people who would stand up at conferences and say, this is just all formalism. It certainly ran counter to the statistical orthodoxy of his day. So in, say, 1939, the giants in the field were R.A. Fisher, Jerzy Neyman. These were both, they didn't agree about very much, but they did agree that they didn't believe in the Bayesian approach, and yet this is something that Turing actually used. Okay, so here's a summary of the talk. In 1939, Bayesian statistics had gone into eclipse. I'll then talk about Turing's Bayesian approach to cryptanalysis. I'll give two examples. One will be the Enigma machine, this device I mentioned, and secondly, something called Tunny, which was another important German crypto system. And then I'll also talk about the post-war aftermath. Okay, so here's a little background. So well known to many of you, but there's the famous Laplace, 1749 to 1827. Now, the trouble is when you get pictures off the internet, you always have to worry about their authenticity. Is this really a picture of the person they claim to be? But since this is from a postage stamp of the République Française, I figure it's probably authentic. So this is one picture of Laplace. And he was the dominant figure in probability in the 19th century. Absolutely, so his théorie analytique just dominated for a century. It's very impressive, when you have a book that just completely takes over a field like that. So this is, there are books that you don't read from cover to cover, but you read sections, and I'd claim this was a book that you read this when you were interested in that. So the théorie analytique des probabilités. And it championed a subjective view of probability, so without question. And so this was a dominant view as a result. And here's a quotation. The word chance then only expresses our ignorance of the causes of the phenomena that we occur and to succeed one another in no apparent order. Probability is relative in part to this ignorance and in part to our knowledge. This was the Laplacian view. But after Laplace died, frequentists rejected Laplace's subjective Bayesian viewpoint. So even just shortly, a few years after in the Académie Française, people would start arguing. And by the 20th century, there were influential critics, including R.A. Fisher. And I could read you, I've written, but you could, there are these wonderful quotations from Fisher. And here's a picture, a famous picture of Fisher posed in front of his calculating machine. And also Egon Pearson and Jerzy Neyman were also anti-Bayesians. And by 1939, the statistical smart set had turned their back on Bayes. This was just not the right way to do things. It was subjective, Okay, and so why, that raises this question though about why were the cryptanalysts at Bletchley Park so receptive to this, given that out there in the academic world, people thought this is terrible stuff. Okay, so dramatis personae number one, Alan Turing, who got an OBE after the war for his contributions. So it was recognized by the government that he'd done good stuff. And here's a picture of him, and it's a little hard to read, but this is from Mind, philosophy journal. And this is his famous article, Computing Machinery and Intelligence. And here's a brief bio of him. He was an undergraduate at King's College, which is a little funny already by itself, because if you were a mathematician, you wanted to go to Trinity. King's was, of course, pretty good too. He wrote a fellowship dissertation on the central limit theorem in 1934-35. So he was listening to a set of lectures by Eddington, and Eddington gave sort of a physicist's sketch or heuristic argument, but Turing was a mathematician, so he decided to go off and prove it by himself. And then afterwards he found out, he was told, well, actually this is not really new, but it was original enough so they could write. Back then you wrote a fellowship dissertation on the basis of which you could become a fellow at Cambridge, which is what happened. And in fact, he was elected a fellow of King's in 1935. And then he wrote, while he was waiting to hear about his fellowship, he worked on the Entscheidungs problem, you know, the decision problem in logic, and then got a PhD under Church in Princeton in 1938. So that's his brief history. But then he reported, now I say September 2nd? Maybe, I think that's maybe wrong, and I think it's the 4th. So I think the first was when the Germans attacked. I think the 3rd was maybe when the British declared war, and he showed up the day after the British declaration of war. So this could be a typo. Might be September 4th. But in any case, he showed up today. Yes?
He was already in England, though. He didn't have to cross the Atlantic.
That's right. He came back in 38. The Brits knew that the war was looming, and so there were actually a set of courses that they had in cryptanalysis for a select number of people in the university establishment. And he actually was attending courses. Before the war broke out, actually.
Why the PhD?
He was interested in logic, right? I don't think he needed it to get a permanent job at Cambridge.
Just because he had gone to study with
Jerzy? Yeah, I think so. You know, he went to study, worked on something, so you get a PhD. Maybe that was just the bureaucratic arrangement or whatever. But before the war, you could easily become a fellow without a PhD.
So this history doesn't have him interacting with people that the smart set of statisticians you spoke of. Maybe you'll get to that.
Nothing. No. Zero. I mean, it's this fellowship dissertation that gets him his.
Inspired by listening to whom?
Eddington. You know, a physicist was giving this set of lectures on foundations of physics, and so at some point the central limit theorem comes in, and Eddington gave a physicist's heuristic sketch, and that just made Turing uncomfortable.
So in all appearances, he was unaware of this whole tradition of probability and mathematical statistics.
Right. Or maybe he knew a little bit, but he had no formal education in it, whatever. But this is his MO. I mean, what's going on with this thing, okay? What's going on with the famous Turing machines, right? So he's waiting to find out about his fellowship. And so he goes to another set of lectures by a guy called Max Newman, who was talking about Hilbert's address to the International Congress of Mathematicians. And Hilbert, was talking about, there's the completeness problem and the consistency problem, and those have been solved by Gödel. And now there's this Entscheidungs problem, the third one. Is there a decision procedure? You give me a sentence, I can tell you if it can be proved or not. And Newman said, it's open question. So most people would find that very intimidating. But Turing's whole MO is, you give me an interesting hard problem. I don't care that other people have crashed and burned. I don't care that I don't even have a lot of technical background. I'm just going to go at it. First principles. Which is why it was so good in Bletchley Park. When you show up at Bletchley Park, There's no manual on how to break German codes. It's a hard problem that people are stuck on. It was the perfect environment for him. But his, you know, knowledge of sort of stochastics is all self-taught.
And we don't know at this point his sources for it.
Sources for
even books. What did he read? What was do you think he read? I mean,
he might have skimmed some stuff, but it's all. He certainly didn't. Now another thing is there's no real probability in Cambridge at that point anyway. So. But Lindeberg proved the central limit theorem in 1922. And although Lindeberg has this condition, the special case is the IID case. So when's the first time the central limit theorem for IID random variables, two variables, is proved? And the answer is Lindeberg's thesis in 1922. Everything before then is, you know, special cases. Markov method of moments, you require an infinite number of moments, and so on. But the two variable IID central limit theorem is a special case of what Lindeberg did in 1922. Turing's fellowship dissertation has a different condition, but it includes as a special case as the IID case. So he, as a finishing undergraduate at Cambridge, is doing a result that until 13 years before was better than anything in the probability literature, even though he's not a probability person. So incredibly impressive. Okay. Now, we're going to talk a little bit about the Enigma. And so the Enigma was this encryption device that was used out in the field, typically for short tactical messages. So here's General Heinz Guderian. Book's still in print. If you go to Amazon, Achtung Panzer. And this is in his command vehicle. And you can see some people who are hunched over this little typewriter. And this little typewriter is an example of the Enigma machine. And it's an offline encryption device, which means that one of the people is typing stuff in, and then someone, and when you type, the encrypt or decrypted letter lights up, and someone else notes that. So if you'd like, you could even have three people. One person says A. I type in A, E shows up, and then someone else writes that down. And so you can see that several people clustered over this machine. And it's actually, if you go online, this is a famous picture. There are very few pictures of the Enigma in actual use, presumably because for security reasons. You know, you weren't supposed to. But this is one of the famous pictures of it. Okay, so the Dance of the Seven Veils, information about Turing's role only came out about three decades later. Okay, so World War II is over in 1945, and it's only around 1974 that information starts coming out. So 1974, the first. So now there, you can find some literature before then, but not in. So in England, you were strictly forbidden from saying anything before 1974. But then Gustave Bertrand, a Frenchman, published a book in 1973, and I think that at that point the Brits decided we can't keep a lid on this anymore. So that's when it first became possible to write about this stuff. Then Jack Good got into the act. Turing, of course, had died several decades earlier, but Good started writing about Turing's, some of the technical aspects of what they did. And so, in particular, he wrote an article that appeared in the journal Biometrica in 1979 called A.M. Turing's Statistical Work in World War II. And then in 1993, he wrote a paper, Enigma and Fish. So Fish is a teleprinter system I'll also talk about. And then in 2000, Turing's anticipation of empirical Bayes in connection with the cryptanalysis of the naval Enigma. And in this paper, Good explains how this famous sampling of species paper he wrote is the main idea came from Turing. And during the last decade, there's lots of original technical materials come out. So now there's an enormous, not everything, but most things have been declassified. Excuse me. Okay, so now there's this paper, The Applications of Probability to Cryptography. Excuse me. So 2012 was the centenary of the birth of Turing. And so in April 2012, GCHQ, which is the United Kingdom equivalent of the NSA, released two reports that Turing had written during World War II. And one of them is this Applications of Probability to Cryptography. And the other was a more technical, shorter paper called Paper on the Statistics of Repetitions. And these explain Turing's approach. So this first paper is, in a certain sense, it's like an introduction to newbies who show up at Bletchley Park, and it gives this sort of general explanation of the approach. And they go beyond the information in these papers that Jack Good wrote. Good was always, as I'll discuss later, very careful, with good reason, in terms of what he would and wouldn't say, but this is an actual paper written by Turing during the war. Okay, so what was Turing's philosophy? What is probability? Well, he starts off in this paper that I'm going to be now discussing, this paper that was released in 2012 but written by him during the war. He begins by giving a brief informal definition of the term. The probability of an event on certain evidence is the proportion of cases in which that event may be expected to happen given that evidence. So this is sort of an interesting definition if you think about it, because he's blending a lot of different elements here, right? So there's knowledge. It's based on certain evidence, but there's frequency, the proportion of cases, and there's the belief may be expected to happen. So, you know, he has a very pragmatic, holistic view of what's going on. He blends all of these elements together. Now, another thing he's big on is you use only part of the evidence. The practical Bayesian does not need to or want to condition on all of the evidence. So when the whole evidence about some event is taken into account, it may be extremely difficult to estimate the probability of the event, even very approximately. And it may be better to form an estimate based on a part of the evidence so that the probability may be more easily calculated. So remember, this is very pragmatic. He's not a philosopher. The bottom line is you need to get the job done. And actually quickly, too, right? If you break the naval enigma message 3 weeks later, it's completely useless. What you want to know about today, ideally, but tomorrow at the latest, where the U-boat is, so you can send out word to the various convoys to avoid it or the planes to shoot it down. So you have to be very pragmatic, and that's his whole approach. And part of the pragmatism is knowing what to throw away and what to keep. And I invite you to contrast this with some caricatures of the Bayesian approach. And, you know, where it's impossible. You know, I've heard people say, well, you know, the Bayesian has to take account of everything. That's impossible. Well, no, that's not how real Bayesians work. What about a priori probabilities? Because this is obviously something that Turing has to deal with. So effective cryptanalysis, according to Turing, involves combining two types of information. The evidence concerning the possibility of an event occurring usually divides into a part about which statistics are available or some mathematical method can be applied, and a less definite part about which one can only use one's judgment. Okay, so the less definite part refers to the so-called prior probabilities. So what's an orthodox critique of prior probabilities? We should avoid using subjective probabilities, because what we should really do is collect further data of an objective nature. Right? That's a sort of standard. So if you read Fisher and so on, that's a sort of standard kind of response. I'm a scientist. What's the subjective stuff? Just let's get more data so that we don't have to mess around with that. Well, this objection, though, loses its force in certain situations. For example, situations in which getting more data isn't an option. All you have is what you have. There's a substantial amount of prior information, so it really seems sort of inefficient to just ignore it because it's not something you can precisely quantify. And you have to make a decision with a limited amount of time. We don't have time to get a grant proposal out to get more stuff. The key thing is, these were all true at Bletchley Park. Okay, if you're trying to break a message, that's what you have. You have a substantial, as time goes on, these guys have a lot of information. They get to know the habits of certain people who are sending the messages. They may have some idea of what the content of the message is. You know, as time goes on, these guys have a lot of information. And finally, as just discussed, you know, you have to figure out what's going on quickly. Breaking the message a month from now is useless. So the point, just to get back to that, is, you know, you had these factors at Bletchley that were making the objections, the standard objections to the Bayesian approach. They just didn't hold any water. You were in a situation where the Bayesian approach was, in fact, the natural one. Okay, so there's this Bayes factor in favor of a hypothesis that Good defines. So he says, nearly all applications of probability to cryptography depend on the factor principle or Bayes' theorem. So if H is an hypothesis, So that might be an encryption setting, right? So you have this device and it has wheels and you want to know how do you set them. And so a hypothesis is a particular setting. H-bar is the negation. It's not that particular setting. And you have E as evidence bearing on the setting, namely the encrypted message. And so O of H is the initial odds in favor of H. So the probability of H divided by 1 minus the probability of H. So that's the initial odds. O of H given E is the odds after observing E. So it's the probability divided by 1 minus the probability, but it's in the light of the evidence. And so the factor is the ratio of those two. It's the posterior odds over the prior odds. That's Turing's factor. And so I still teach the regular version of Bayes' theorem, but what we should really do is start out with the odds ratio version instead. And so Bayes' theorem identifies Turing's factor as the likelihood ratio. So the posterior odds in favor of one hypothesis versus another is the prior odds for that hypothesis versus the other times the likelihood ratio. Right, so the probability of E given H1, one hypothesis versus. So what the likelihood ratio is saying is, how likely is this what we've seen in the light of the different possible explanations?
So Stanley, this, mm-hmm. You put that in quotations. You use this phrase factor principle.
Quotations. You mean?
On the previous slide, you were quoting Turing directly.
Right.
And so this phrase factor principle, which he puts in quotes.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That
he uses that term. I don't know that it precedes him in any way. At some point, Jack Good asked him, when he was learning this stuff, he asked Turing, isn't this like Bayes' theorem? And Turing's response was, I suppose so. So, I suppose so says two things. It's not, what is Bayes' theorem? So he's heard this expression, but I suppose so is, that's not how I got to here. Yes, it's a factor. Right. So, as I said, he has no academic training in probability and statistics. It's all self-taught. So now if E, the evidence you have, consists of independent sources of information, then one of the strengths of this approach is that the posterior odds is the prior odds times, you have that the overall likelihood ratio factors into the, each factor corresponds to an independent piece of evidence. Okay, and part of the reason that's useful is to ease computing. Now, another thing is, remember, it's all practical, right? So Turing introduces the notion of the deciband, which is 10 times the log base 10 of the odds. So one of the useful things is if you hit this guy with logs, products turn into sums, and so this is 10 times the sum, 10 times the log of the individual guys, plus 10 times the log of the prior odds. So you convert multiplication into addition. And the factor of 10 was used to simplify the arithmetic. Now, for the statisticians who have all heard of Jack Good, one of the things that's interesting about this whole episode is Jack might have gotten his, had a certain interesting practical side to him, even though he was a pure mathematician. Jack Good introduced a factor of 20 instead of 10. Doesn't sound very impressive, right? But Jack says, let's use 20 instead of 10. Why? He said, this must have saved half the time of the work on banbarismus, which was the process that was in view. In other words, the point is, you were getting rid of an extra, real people had to do this by hand, and you were getting rid of an unnecessary additional digit this way. And this halved the amount of time that it actually took for people to do the calculations. So it's sort of interesting that you have to have the right mindset to appreciate it. It may not be impressive, 20 instead of 10, but if it saves you half the work, that's good. So here's just a simple example. As I said, I haven't yet brought myself to do this, but we should really do this approach to teaching things. Suppose you're teaching tossing a coin that's either two-headed, call that H, or fair, and I don't know, something happened here. This should be the H bar. Sorry about that. If it's heads once, what's the Bayes factor in favor of H? It's 2, right? Because the probability that if the coin is two-headed, what's the probability you get a head? And it's head, one, right? You'll see the head. On the other hand, if it's fair, the probability you get a head is a half, so it's one divided by half is two. So the base factor is two, and then when you do 10 log base 10 of two, you get three. So you would have a factor of three decimans in favor of the hypothesis. So suppose you got 20 heads in a row. Because of the additivity, it just becomes 3 times 20, or 60 decibands. And if the initial odds were 10,000 to 1 against it being two-headed, you can do the calculation. You get minus 40 decibands. Well, 60 decibands minus 40 is 20 decibands in favor, which becomes, if you now invert the logarithm process, odds of 100 to 1. So this just illustrates, you know, when you think about it this way, it's very, very easy to do calculations quickly. And it's just a very natural way of thinking about things. Clear? Okay, now in his paper, Turing gives four examples. One is called the visionaire cipher, which is a very classical kind of cipher. You use a sort of a Caesar cipher, Caesar shift, but with different alphabets. Something called a letter subtractor problem, theory of repeats, and transposition ciphers. So these are all classical things. It's not like he's bringing something new to the table. This is really a pedagogic paper. But he's illustrating how you can approach these things using this mindset. And in each case, he develops the necessary mathematics and computational shortcuts to make the resulting calculations manageable. So he's not only saying what theoretically what to do, but he's also saying, here's how we could actually do it by hand in some reasonable amount of time. So the theory of repeats actually was key to the attack on the naval enigma, so I'll spend a little time talking about that particular example. So what's the theory of repeats? in the technical cryptologic literature, a depth refers to a situation where two or more messages are encrypted at the same setting. Okay, so I turn the wheels on my Enigma machine, and then I use it to encipher a message. And then for the next message, I'll use the same setting. And for many devices, if you're in that world, this is a major insecurity, sending messages in depth. And finding these depths was a key part of the attack on the naval Enigma. If you could find two messages that were actually sent at the same setting, this was gave you a crack in to breaking the code. So here's the method of finding. Suppose we have two messages, A1 through AN and B1 through BN. The repeat rate is the probability that the A and B will be the same. Okay, so what's the probability that AJ, the letter here is the same as the letter there? Well, assuming these are independent streams. Well, one thing is they could both be an A. So what's the chance of that? It's P sub A squared. Another thing is they could both be the letter B. And what's the chance of that? It's, 1 over 26. So let P sub B be the chance of seeing a B. So what's the chance that both are B? It's P sub B squared by the independence. What's the chance that they're both C? P sub C squared, and so on. What's the chance that they're the same? I'm not going to tell you which letter, but one of the 26 letters are the same, and the answer is the sum of the P's squared. So the sum K goes from A to Z of P sub K squared. So that's the repeat rate. If you look at two strings, what's the chance that you'll see the same letter at some given spot? So that's what we're looking for. Is now for random letters, it's 1 in 26. Random, Glenn, in the 19th century sense, right? For random letters, uniform probability, it's 1 in 26 that you'll have each of the 26 letters. So the point is, it's 1 in 26 squared 26 times. So it's 1 in 26. That's the repeat rate. But, human text is not uniform. And so, suppose you see six Suppose you see six encrypted letters in a row repeated. So if that's the case, see, if you see the two things matching up, Well, you know, how unusual is that? Well, in a classical test of significance, you'd compute the probability of the data given a null hypothesis that the fit is correct. So, and that, you know, level of significance or p-value is sufficiently small, you take that as evidence against the null. Okay, so the idea is if the null hypothesis would be, we have six repeats, okay, a six long stretch of letters that repeat, and the null hypothesis is, well, it's just at random, and it's just a chance occurrence. And so what you do is you calculate the probability of that, the probability of six repeats. And so that's 1 in 26 cubed to the sixth, which is a really small number. Okay, so if you find, if you're looking at text and you find these six and these six in a row, that would be unusual. Okay, so that's the significance probability approach. But this is very small, but even under the competing alternative of a correct fit, the probability of seeing a matching hexagram is also quite small. Right? We're trying to say, is this just a chance thing, or are we looking at actual encrypted matching up? So for example, in the case of the naval enigma, the repeat rate was roughly 1/17. So if you like, that's in German, you know, so you could have a repeat rate for letters in English, right? Etain Schrödlo, at E is the most common, followed by T and A, and so on. German military text is another thing. But, you know, text, it's not going to be 1 in 26 repeat rate. And so empirically, the repeat rate was about 1 in 17. So if this was an encrypted message, and that's why things are repeating, this would also be pretty small. 1 in 17 to the sixth. So the point is, whether or not, so it seems uninformative, whether or not we're looking at a message and it's just random, or they actually really are genuine repeats arising from the fact that we have the same system. This isn't, you know, these p-values aren't distinguishing between those two cases. So it's too small. So doing better is not the absolute magnitudes of these guys, but their relative magnitudes, a ratio. So if you take the ratio of those two things, it's about close to 13. Okay? It's 13 times more likely that we would see six repeats in a row if what's happening underneath the hood, you know, before the encryption, is these are actually the same, you know, this is military German versus flat random. See, the idea is if you're, okay, so that's, so the observed data is nearly 13 times as likely to occur given the correct fit versus an incorrect fit. So the idea is this would be weight in favor of, we're actually looking at encrypted text, okay, as opposed to, these. So here's one thing. I have basically, think of this as two strings, and if let's imagine that they're in depth, okay, that they've been at the same setting, but I don't know when that happened. So in this string, it started out at the same setting. This is the setting. And in this other string, it's over here that you use that setting, okay? So the idea is you want to slide these messages along to find out at which point it's at the same setting at the same point. And the idea is as you're sliding it along and you don't have that matchup, then it's just like two random strings of text and you're going to have that 1 in 26 guy. But when you superimpose them and you are at this point where they reflect the same setting, then it's like you have two strings in military German and then the repeat rate shoots up to 1 in 17 from 1 in 26. So that's the flag for picking up is that when you have these things in the right alignment, the repeat rate should shoot up as a result. So that's what you're looking for. And this is a way of quantifying that. And so it's getting six in a row matching up gives you a factor of 13 in favor of this correct alignment versus random. Unfortunately, in the classical Neyman theory of hypothesis testing, this problem would be viewed as one of deciding between two simple hypotheses based on the error rates. And this approach neglects the prior odds for against correctness of the fit. So for example, depending on the circumstances, you might have more or less reason to believe the messages were in the depth. Okay. There might be indicators or whatever in the message. And you have more or less reason to think that they were properly aligned. So this approach, the Neyman Pearson approach is not taking that kind of prior information into account. Let me just say one other thing. I'm going to give a practical example later, which will be a challenge to the statisticians in the sense that I don't know a way that you would actually approach this in a non-Bayesian way. So I'll give a concrete, pretty simple, easily understood example. Okay, so that was Alan Turing. Now, a second person in our little story is Jack Good, I.J. Good. And here's a picture of Jack. Jack was a pretty good chess player. Here's him in a, I guess he won the Cambridgeshire Championship one year. This is a picture of him later in life after he emigrated to the US. And here's a short bio. He was an undergraduate at Jesus College, graduating in 1938. He won the Smith's Prize. So you have this, after you graduate, you can submit an essay. He won that year, very prestigious. In 1941, he then got his PhD under G.H. Hardy and Besakovich. So he was basically working in analysis slash number theory. He's a pure mathematician. And then he reports to Bletchley Park in 1941. And he was, in fact, Turing's main statistical assistant from 41 to 43. The first 2 years, he was in Hut 8, which was Naval Enigma. And in the last 2 years, he was in the Numinary, which worked on a separate important system, which was a teleprinter system. Okay, so 1943, Good moves to the Numinary after spending 2 years in the Naval Enigma. And this was to work on a new system codenamed Tunny. And here's an example of the Tunny device. It was very complicated. It had 12 wheels. Five wheels moved regularly. Five wheels moved irregularly. You had two other wheels. One moved regularly. The regular wheel caused the second wheel to move irregularly. And the second irregular wheel caused the other five wheels to move irregularly. It was a very complicated device for encrypting teleprinter messages. And so something called the Lorentz SZ, Schlüssel-Zusatz, had different versions, 4042, online, as I said, teleprinter encryption device. And it would be used to send long messages, several thousand characters, and used by Hitler and his generals. So for example, there's this famous telegram, there's this famous message that Hitler sent, you know, to the commandant in Paris when the city was about to fall, saying, you know, basically level the place and burn it. And I'm morally certain that this message was sent in encrypted form via this Tunny device. And came into general use in 1942. Okay, now the structure of Tunny, it was pretty complicated. It was five impulse codes. So you had five bits. So 2 to the 5, 32 different things you can encode. So here, this was what encoded the A, this is encoded the B, and so on. The encryption was used. So in other words, you could just use this to convert A and B into various things, but then the idea is you encrypt the message in addition. And the way this was done was they had five chi wheels, which moved in a regular fashion. They had five psi wheels that moved irregularly, and these two mu wheels that determined when the irregular motion occurred. And so a way of schematizing this is you have the P, which is plain text, and you dump on it this psi wheel. So you already encrypted things a bit. So the idea is plain text is being encoded by five bits. And you have five wheels, and each of the wheels is doing something to each of the five bits. So you take your plain text and you dump this psi thing on it, and then already you're encrypted. But then you, in addition, dump on a second layer of encryption by the chi wheels, and that gives you C, the ciphertext. Okay, so that's the P plus psi plus chi is ciphertext. Okay, so the attack on Tunny was due to a design flaw. So plain text has statistical regularities into it. And the whole purpose of the encryption, or major goal in encryption, is to hide the statistical regularities. So, but due to a design flaw, the P plus psi thing actually preserved a certain amount of statistical irregularity, non-uniformity. And now remember, you have these five bits, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And so the idea is if you took two of them and combined them, that irregularity was preserved. Okay, so you initially in this attack, you don't take all five bits, you just take two, you add them up, and that looks at, so instead of having 0, 1, and what looks like a completely random string, you have zeros and ones, but there's a slight bias. Doesn't have to be a lot. You have a slight bias that you can generate from this thing. So suppose that this denotes the combination before stripping off the chi. So we have these two layers, okay? That's statistically irregular. And suppose the d's represent what happens. Suppose you were able to strip this off. Now call the stream of bits d's. Okay, that's statistically regular too, because once I've stripped this thing off, you have this design flaw that these things, now by regular, I don't mean it's, you know, 1, 1, 1, 1, but I'm saying it exhibits a bias. If you can successfully strip this guy off, at this level, all looks random. But if you strip this guy off, what's left, although encrypted, does betray some statistical regularity. So there are two stages of the attack. The Neumann, they actually had two separate divisions at Bletchley Park to do this stuff. The guys in the Neumannery stripped off the chi using essentially statistical methods, and then the guys in something called the testery stripped off the psi level using linguistic methods, and voila, you have the plain text. But by the way, okay, so what was the attack? So you have these two, you know, you have five wheels. So you have five chi wheels, chi 1, chi 2, chi 3, chi 4, chi 5. And the idea is you look at these two first two wheels, and they had, I forget what the number is, like 43 and 41, something like that. You multiply them together, and you'll get a total of 1,271 possible settings. So here's where it comes statistically interesting. You apply this, you take the ciphertext, and you take the first two bits, and you look at all possible 1,271 settings. Okay? And if it's wrong, you actually haven't stripped the cipher off. You've just added something else, and it still looks random. Zero ones with probability a half. But in one of the 1,271 cases, you're right, you've actually stripped this off, you've actually discovered, you will recognize this by having a slightly biased stream. So that was the whole nature of the attack. Just go through all 1,271 settings, and so what you're looking at is you have 1,271 streams, 1,270 which are flat random, unbiased, and one of which has a slight bias. And that's the wedge by which you figure out. And then the rest of the attack is just, you know, keep on building on that. Okay, so the mission, should we choose to accept it, is to find the one bias stream among the 1,271. So if you like, I've now translated this into a pure statistics problem. Here are 1,271. Okay, so the general report in Tunney tells us, so this is where my challenge problem is going to come in. It says, suppose the best score is 4 sigma without serious rivals. So in other words, the null is that it's flat random. And let's say I have 2,000 characters. And I say, how likely is it to get this biased stream if the actual mechanism is genuinely random, coin tossing? Okay. In other words, I have 2,000 coin tosses, and I get 1,200 heads and 800 tails. That's unusual. You calculate the probability of that, the z-score or whatever. And so this is saying, suppose the best score, so you look at the 1,271 settings, and one of them is, you know, find the one that is most discrepant. And suppose it's 4 sigma without serious rivals. 4 sigma or better occurs once in at random once in 30,000. So it would be natural to imagine that the odds of the setting are 30,000 divided by, but remember, it's a multiple comparisons thing, right? We're looking at 1,271 things. So Bonferroni, a natural thing is to divide this by 1,271, and you get 23 to 1 on. So in other words, before Jack Good came over to this, so Jack is being sent over as the, he understands Turing's approach. And he's being sent over, and the guys in this unit are doing the old-fashioned fuddy-duddy statistical significance test approach. And they think, hey, 4 sigma, it's a lock. And Good says it's more like 3 to 1 on. So even after a factor has been set against all the other settings due to the existence of no serious rival, so even after you take this divide by 1,271, Okay, although the odds depend to a reasonable extent on the particular link, you know, you have two people communicating to each other and the length of the tape, and also D is the, have to do with the nature of this bias that's interjected. So this was not unimportant. In the very early days of the section, there was a tendency to continue with the message for some time if it gave a 4 sigma, since it was not believed that the odds could be much below 20 to 1 on. This was before the DESID ban had been brought over from HUD 8. By good. So the point is to realize you have these two organizations. The first one, the Numinary guys, stripped this off, and then the second one, the Testery guys, stripped this off. But remember, when the Numinary guys strip this off, they think they've stripped it off. This stuff still looks random. I mean, you know, it's encrypted. There's still this remaining. So you don't. In other words, if you're in a sort of simple cryptographic system, if you're right, and you apply it, and you're right, you see text, you see English, right? They weren't being faced with that. When they came up with what they thought was the right setting, it still looked like gobbledygook. And then it gets sent over to the Testery guys. And there's a problem. Suppose these guys are wrong. Testery guys just waste time for a day or so before they throw in the towel. So it's not enough to get the most likely answer. You need to know that it's actually likely to be right. But the point is, you don't actually get the answer, right? You're just passing it on to these other guys. So what's going on? The question is not just like how unlikely it is for a random string of zeros and ones to result in 4 sigma, but how strong the evidence is in favor of its doing so. So this is basically going to be my challenge. So OK, so if the you have these 1271 hypotheses, they're the possible settings. And xj is the score under certain hypothesis. So it's the number of ones using the HJ setting. So I take the actual encrypted text under a certain hypothesis. I think this is the setting. And so I use it to, I think, strip off the encryption. And XJ is the result. And if you P is one thing, Q is the other. So here are the posterior odds that you're right. It's P over Q. So P is the bias. Okay, so it's P over Q to the XI over, and then you, and so this is an example of Bayes' theorem where the alternatives are equally likely. So because, you know, one wheel setting, as far as you know, is just as likely to be the right wheel setting as another. So in that case, the Bayes' theorem simplifies into it's the one relative likelihood divided by the others. Okay, so that's the likelihood ratio. But that's the posterior odds, actually. But the point is, you can actually calculate it. And so this depends not only on P, the bias, but also on N, the length of the message, via these XJs, which are the scores that you're doing. OK, so now Jack Good says in this, where are we? So he says that, well, I won't go all the way back. But he says people thought it was 20 to 1, and actually it's 3 to 1 odds. So, well, we can actually figure it out. But this is actually random, right? I mean, you have, you know, you can think of this random generating mechanism, and you'll get a different answer every time. So we can use Monte Carlo here. And to take a specific example, suppose you have a message that's 1080 long, and the bias is 0.55, which is about right for this situation. A 4 sigma result would correspond to getting 606. So in other words, if you toss a coin 1080 times, and you got to what would give you a 4 sigma result, you know, compared to flat random, and the answer would be 606. So suppose H is the true setting, and so you actually scored 606. The posterior probability depends on the remaining 1270 values of XJ. So let's go all the way back, right? I mean, this is the actual posterior probability. It's not just the one, the best score, but it also depends on how them other guys are doing. And you can do an R experiment. So I did an experiment, 1,000 trials. On average, the posterior odds in favor of H based on a score of 606 came out as 2.97. So Jack Good was completely right on the mark. And I'm using realistic numbers in terms of. So this is my challenge. And I actually don't know how to do this in a non-Bayesian way. you have 1,271 streams of zeros and ones. 1,270 of them have been generated by using fair coin tossing. And one of them has been generated using a coin that has a bias 55-45. And your goal is to find the biased stream. But don't come to me and say, this is the best candidate, because you can get punished, right? You send the best candidate over to the other section, and a day later they just say, we can't get anywhere. Are you sure this is right? I don't want you to tell me that this is your best candidate for the biased stream. I want you to tell me this is likely to be the best stream. And that's what this Bayesian approach was doing. If the odds were 10 to 1 that this was biased, then, you know, that this was the actual biased stream corresponding to the right setting, then they'd send it over to the test tree guys. But if it was only 3, then they would say, we have lots of messages. There's no particular one to focus our time on this message. There are lots of messages. We're not going to bother with messages where the posterior odds are 3 to 1 or 4 to 1. We're going to wait till we get a message where the odds are 10 to 1 or 20 to 1, and then we'll send it over to the other guys because we don't want to waste their time. So I don't know a non-Bayesian way of dealing with that. Okay, now I'm going to quickly wrap up. I have a little more to say. Probability and the weighing of evidence. So as some of you may know, immediately after the war, Jack Good wrote a book setting out his Bayesian philosophy, which was published in 1950. Well, Probability and the Weighing of Evidence. In his preface, he wrote, Dr. A.M. Turing, Professor M.H.A. Neyman, and Mr. D. Mickey were good enough to read the first draft, written in 1946, and I am most grateful for the numerous suggestions. Well, okay. So Turing was his buddy over in Hut 8. Max Neyman was running the Neymanry. That's why it was called the Neymanry. He was the head of the section that was doing the Tunney attack. And Mickey was one of Good's colleagues. So the guys who are giving him comments in the draft, this is a book that he wrote because of his World War II experience, directly after his World War II experience. After that, many papers follow from Good. So Good tells us, he says, Turing did not publish these wartime statistical ideas because after the war, he was too busy working on the ground floor of computer science and artificial intelligence. I was impressed by the importance of his statistical ideas for other applications and developed and published some of them in various places. Much of my delay was caused by the wartime attitude that everything was classified, from Hollerith cards to sequential statistics to empirical Bayes to Markov chains to decision theory to electronic computers. These extreme standards of secrecy only gradually abated after the war. And so in other words, he can never talk about the cryptographic applications, but can you even just write a vanilla paper talking about a certain development? And what he's saying was initially the answer was no, but then as time went on, it became possible to do that, and that's when he started publishing things. But he couldn't be too explicit at first. So for example, in his 1979 paper, so he wrote this paper in 79 in Biometrica on Turing's work on probability in World War II, the deciband, that 10 log base 10 thing, is described as being part of an important classified process called band barismus. But he doesn't tell you what band barismus actually does. The main use of the deciband was to sequential analysis, not for quality control, but for discriminating between hypotheses. But he doesn't tell you what the hypotheses were. Right, so he's being very careful to draw this careful line. So now this must have been very frustrating for him because he couldn't talk about one of the outstanding success stories of Bayesian statistics, despite vocal assertions that these did not exist. Let's see, I went to some conference 10,000 years ago in the 70s in Waterloo, on the University of Waterloo, on foundations of statistics. And Jack Good gave a talk. So this is 72, so this is before it becomes possible to talk about things. So Jack Good gives his talk, and then a guy called Oscar Kempthorne, who was a sort of old-line Fisherian-type guy from Iowa, gets up and says, and I'm not kidding, he says something like, Jack, how can you go on conference after conference spouting this nonsense about Bayesian, there's no real applications, no nothing. You know, it must be so incredibly frustrating. You don't want to scream. Well, no, actually, on a day-by-day basis, we use this thing for real at Bletchley Park, but he couldn't say anything. Must have been very frustrating. But his caution here was well advised. The sorry story of Gordon Welchman. Just to give you a sense of how sensitive these things were, Hut 6 did Army Enigma. And so Welchman was the head of Hut 6. And so he doesn't say nothing. And he, at some point, he emigrates to the US. And then in the 70s, people start publishing stuff finally, right? The embargo. So in 1982, Welchman writes this wonderful book called The Hut 6 Story, where he talks about things in detail. But he makes a big mistake. He's in the US, he's not in the UK. He doesn't submit this to the UK authorities for clearance. And they go absolutely through the ceiling. They complain to the US, and Welchman loses his clearance as a result. And he's forbidden to talk to the press. He becomes persona non grata because he's published a book. Now, when you read the book, it's hard to see what, you know, what was considered so sensitive in 1982. But okay, so this is so, you know, Good had good reason to be careful. If you violated your pledge of secrecy, you got in big time trouble. But the 500-page general report on Tunney will now make up for that. So the point is that at the end of the war, in May 1945, Neyman, the head of the section, goes off to resume his job at Manchester, and he tells Good and Mickey and Timms, who are sticking around for another several months, he says, you need to write this stuff up. So they write a 500-page report, which you can now buy online from Amazon, because a scholarly edition has come out. They write a 500-page report where they go in unbelievable detail on every aspect of the attack on this machine. It's probably the most detailed discussion of a cryptologic attack ever. I mean, 500 pages, tons of mathematics. So it remains highly classified until maybe 12 years ago. It finally got released. But now we know 100% what they're doing because this is, you know, 500 pages. One final thing is I.J. Good, philosopher of science, besides doing Bayesian statistics, a lot of which, by the way, when you you can track and see that a lot of Good's work after the, for at least 15, 20 years after the war, a lot of it stems from his Bletchley Park experiences. You can sort of see in retrospect, partly because we have this general report in Tunney, and we can say, oh, I see, he's doing the same thing here. Partly because sometimes he was very good about acknowledging Turing's role if Turing had made a contribution. And so, you, like the fast Fourier transform was something he found out from Turing during the war. And Good did some very nice work on that, which he, and he acknowledges Turing, so we know that's where it came from. But he was also a philosopher at heart, and so he published extensively in the philosophical literature, espousing Bayesian statistics. Much of this, of course, you know, before the embargo is listed, so it's just in the general sense that this is good stuff to use. And so this includes 22 papers in the British Journal for the Philosophy of Science, by my count, 7 papers in philosophy of science, 3 in synthèse, and multiple conference proceedings. So Good had this mission in life, if you like, to try to talk up the Bayesian approach. And wasn't just within the community of statisticians, but also within the philosophical community. Okay. For references, you could see my, I wrote a paper, Alan Turing and the Central Limit Theorem. So that was the fellowship dissertation. There was this paper that was released in 2012, and I was asked to write a commentary on it for a journal called Cryptologia. And there's also this, I wrote a, in terms of Tunney, I wrote a paper. So the general report on Tunney, Diffie, Field, Reed's editors, published by IEEE in 2015, is a scholarly edition of this 500-page thing, and I was asked to write an accompanying paper on the statistical methods and so on. Finally, let me close by giving Jack Good the last word. Good wrote, most of the cryptanalysts in the Neumannry dispersed into the various universities, and most of us achieved some measure of success in our unclassified work. But the success of our efforts during the war and the feeling that we were helping substantially and perhaps critically to save much of the world, including Germany, from heinous tyranny was a hard act to follow.